Eric, motivational speaker, author, consultant, educator, passion for people, advocate for action, strategist for change. If you are ready to have fun, take notes, and fuel transformation in your life, please join me in welcoming Mr. A.C. Cristales.
How are you guys doing?
Good.
That's good. That's my crew right there. That's good. See, I acknowledge things that go on within the classroom. Anyways, so I just want to say that I'm excited to be here. I only have about 30 minutes, so I'm going to have to condense my message, okay? But what I want to tell you today is I just want to just share a little bit about me, how I came to be where I'm actually having the opportunity to share my story, to actually have the opportunity to tell you how I started on the bottom, but now Alright. So let me just go ahead and tell you about this. Big dreams. Alright? So raise your hand if you're in this cafeteria and you have big dreams. Raise your hand if you have big dreams. Alright, very good. Very good. So what about it? I don't have any dreamers on this side, but raise your hand again. Let me see it again. Raise your hand if you have big dreams. Keep your hands up high. Alright, very good, very good. Put your hands down. Alright. Now we're not gonna call anybody any losers here. So here's the thing. Alright? You have big dreams. But do you understand that just having big dreams is not enough? Do you understand that? That dreaming big and having dreams is not enough? It's not gonna take you to where you wanna be. So let me just go ahead and jump into real quick. So my story, guys. My story starts 65 years ago. Now, if you look at me, I don't look like I'm 65. At least I hope I don't look like I'm 65. I know I have some gray hair, some wrinkles. In fact, the very first time I saw a wrinkle, I was 30 years old. I was sitting in the barber seat getting a haircut, and I looked in the mirror, and I was like, oh my gosh, I have a wrinkle. I hated it. I'm like, man, I'm getting old, right? Those 30 years old had that wrinkles. But hopefully, I don't look like I'm 65, okay? Hopefully, I don't. Well, look, I'm 65. Thank you so much. Appreciate that. All right. Well, here's the thing. 65 years ago is when my mother was born. All right? 65 years ago is when my mother was born. And if you stay awake during world geography, you'll know that Peru, which is where she grew up, where she was born, is in South America. Now, why is that important? It's important because back then, when she was going to school, back then, when she was 10, 11 years old, if her parents didn't have the money to provide an education for them, then the highest grade level that she could complete was the fifth grade. Now, why is that important? It's important because of this. Because when my mom was 11 years old and she finished the fifth grade, that's all the education she received. Because that's all her parents could afford. They couldn't pay for her to go to middle school. They couldn't pay for her to go to high school. So in the fifth grade, she was done. She was finished. Now, what do you think that she was doing? She was working. Thank you. I'm glad you said that. I'm glad you didn't say, well, maybe she was watching Nick Jr. or Disney Channel or whatever. No. She wasn't watching any Phineas and Ferb. I mean, this is Peru, right? She wasn't watching Pedro y Federico. It wasn't working like that, right? And so, what type of job do you think she had? What type of job do you think she had? She was working in the fields? Okay. Good choice, but no. She was cleaning. She was washing other people's clothes. Now I don't know about you, but I don't like doing laundry. That's not my thing. I don't get excited like, yo, I gotta do laundry. Doesn't just get me excited. But that's what she was doing. And so what she had to do, she had to walk 2 to 3 miles to the nearest neighborhood, rich neighborhood, knock on people's door and say, hey, can I wash your clothes? Now I don't know about you again. Washing somebody else's clothes? Nah, I'm not feeling that, but that's what she had to do. She didn't have a choice. Her mom was just gonna let her stay at home and be on Snapchat, Instagram. Yo, this was back in the day, there was any of that, right? So she had to work. So she's taking loads of clothes, not even her clothes, and not going to a laundromat, not going to a washateria, going to a pond and washing the clothes by hand. Now, I think about that because I remember when my mom told me that story, and I think about how I have it. I have it easy, man. A couple years ago, I bought a house, went to Best Buy, and I purchased a washer and dryer. And then Best Buy came a week later and they installed the washer and dryer. And when I looked at the washer and dryer, I'm like, yo, this is legit. Have you seen washer and dryers now? They got like 20 different buttons. They're like legit. Like all these different buttons. I'm like, yo, this is pretty tight. I want to wash clothes, so that's what I did. I got my first load of clothes, and I put suavitel in, right? That's what Latinos put. You know, we use suavitel, right? I put some suavitel in there. Pushed the button, went into the living room, started watching SportsCenter. Then 30 minutes later, I get startled. I hear a noise that scares me, because I'm the only one in the house. And the noise goes, in my house? And Chupacabra, La Llorona, Rucoy, like, yo, who's in my house? Who's playing classical music in my house? And so, man. So I go into the laundry room, walk, take a couple of steps, and it's my washer signaling that, hey, the clothes are washed. I'm like, yo, this is pretty legit. Look at all these buttons. I'm like, yo, is there a hip-hop version on there? Like, maybe that's a Drake one. I'm like, wait, bam, let me press that. Started from the bottom. Oh, there we go. Yeah, look at it. But you know, I'm Latino, man, so you know, I got like my bachata music and stuff, right? I mean, Aventura, Romeo Santos, like, yo, let me press that button right there.
Yo.
Mi corazoncito, tu ropa está limpia. Yeah, what? That's what I'm talking about. And you're laughing about it, you never know, 5, 10 years from now, Apple's gonna release Apple Washer, Apple Dryer, Apple Microwave, right? But regardless of that, I tell you that because, again, I have it easy. My mom didn't have it easy like that. And so that's where my mom's story starts. Growing up poor, five other siblings. She loses her father at 13 years old. Her father was an alcoholic, had too much to drink, passes away. And yet, she had big dreams. So we're gonna pause right there, and I'm gonna go 1,000 miles north to the country of Guatemala. That's where my father was born, in Guatemala. And just like my mom, he grew up poor as well. In fact, if he was to walk into this cafeteria and stand before you, this is what he'd say. When I was 8 years old, I was shining shoes. Cuando yo tenía 8 años, yo estaba lustrando zapatos. He would say this. He would say that sometimes there wasn't enough food in the house because there was a total of 11 brothers and sisters that he had to search garbage bins and eat scraps of leftover food. And why do I share that story? I'm supposed to be a motivational speaker, but there you are, you're depressing me. You're being very depressing, saying all this sad stuff. I tell you that because I'm not ashamed of my story. I'm not ashamed of my parents' stories, because many times we can be ashamed of who our parents are. But I'll tell you straight out the bat, my mom, highest level education was in fifth grade. My mom didn't go to high school. My mom didn't go to college. My mom doesn't have the education, so she wasn't set up for success, but she had a dream. My dad, the same thing, grew up poor, eating out of the garbage bin. How's that for a story, from rags to riches? No, he was eating out of the garbage bin, but yet he had big dreams. So I'm not ashamed to tell you that story, because the story doesn't end right there. I'm not ashamed to tell you, hey, my mom, she doesn't speak English that well, my dad doesn't either, but they had big dreams. Don't you understand that that's what's important? That it doesn't matter how you start, it matters how you finish? And so that's what I really want you to get as I'm speaking today. That regardless of where you're at right now, you may not like it, you may not have chosen it, but you know what? You can choose to change your destiny. And so they had big dreams, and they came to the United States. Now, I don't know about you, but maybe you can relate with me. Maybe your parents were not born in the United States. Maybe your grandparents were not born in the United States. And so my mom and my dad, they come to the United States. Why? Because for two reasons. Number one, they wanted a better life. Number two, they wanted opportunity. And so they met. Now, I've never asked my mom, hey, mom, how did dad come up to you? How did he meet you? Because I just don't think it's going to be as exciting as I would want it to be, or as romantic as I would want it to be, right? I'm kind of romantic and stuff. I think if I ask her, it's kind of going to be like, yo, mom, how did dad come up to you? Well, I was eating tacos one day, and he asked me if I wanted a horchata. I'm like, yo, yeah, that's it? Yeah, he asked me if I wanted a horchata. Like, nothing else? Like, he didn't ask if you wanted, like, salsa verde or cilantro or... So we eat that? Not eso? No. He just asked me on horchata. Huh. That's not very romantic. You know, that doesn't really, like, I like to picture something different. I like to picture, you know, he walks into a club, and when he sees her, it's like, do-do, 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 and then, because my mom is beautiful. But it wasn't, you know, it wasn't like that. It was probably, get us some taco. Like, yeah, get him taco. And again, I want to picture it differently. I want to picture him going up to her and looking her straight in the eye and going, voila. Because you got to go like that. You can't say, hola, right? So walk away like, what's wrong with this guy, right? Lame, right? No. You got to be smooth. Voila, right? But it wasn't like that. Regardless of how it was, maybe one day I'll have the courage enough to ask her. They met. They were married. And then, a couple months later, my older brother is born. And then, a couple of months after that, my mom's life forever changes. Because see, I didn't mention this, but it's very important. When my father was in Guatemala, he was 13 years old, and he started using drugs. And so, one of the reasons he started using drugs that he would tell me is that because he felt, when he was 13 years old, he had no one he could talk to. He felt alone. He felt like there was no one there who understood him. And so instead of him finding somebody who he could talk to, finding a teacher, finding somebody who he could just share his problems, he didn't do that. He kept it all inside. And can I tell you something? There's a danger. There's a danger in thinking like, hey, nobody's there for me. There's a danger in thinking that, hey, my life is not worth anything. When the reality is that your life is worth something. When the reality is that your life is special. Yeah, my father didn't think that. So how does that affect my mom? Well, they get married and guess what? Every time that he's upset, bam, he slaps her. Every time that he gets mad at her, bam, he punches her. My mom was physically and verbally abused by my father, and she didn't expect that. That's not why she came to the United States. But can I tell you something about life? Is that it's not always fair. And if you're complaining and wish, man, I wish life was better, do you understand? Lesson number one, life isn't always fair. And just like that, her life changed. But here's the thing about my mom. The thing about my mom is that she's a Latina woman, right? So in her culture, you stay with your man. You stick by his side. Now, I'm not saying that's the right thing to do. I have a little 7-year-old daughter, and you better believe that if somebody touches her, I'm like, you don't allow that. But my mom, she wasn't raised that way. She was raised, you stay by your man. You stand by him. But again, that's the way she was raised. And so my father's like, man, this lady's not leading me. Guess what? I'm going to leave him. And so she leaves him. He leaves her. He leaves her, moves to Dallas, Texas. And my mom's like, yo, you know what? I want to try to make this marriage work. I want to make sure that my son has a father in his life. So she follows him. She comes down here. And I'm glad she did that because a couple of years after that, one of the most beautiful things ever happened. Ever. One of the most beautiful things ever happened. What do you think that is? Because you smiled. I was born. Thank you so much, sweetie. You just made my day. She said I was born. Yes! And so now you figure, all right, he's got two boys. Guess what? Now he's going to get his act together, but he doesn't. So my childhood memories of my father are me sitting in the passenger side of his car while he's doing drug deals. My memories of my father's him is me seeing him hit my mom. It was never a situation like, mom, why are you crying? ¿Por qué estás llorando? It was me being right there. He would do it right in front of me. That was my normal. 5-year-old little boy witnessing that. That was my normal. I'm not saying it's a normal thing. I'm telling you that was my normal. And then I'll never forget. 8 years old, I realized that life isn't perfect. 8 years old, my father comes home one day and says, hey, guess what? I'm leaving. And I'm going with another woman. This isn't a novela. No, this is my life. 8 years old, my father says, I'm going with somebody else. And he could tell that I was sad. And so he's like, you know what, mijo? I'll come see you next week. I'm like, really, Dad? He's like, yeah. So next week rolls around and I go and I wait for him at the corner. He says he's gonna be there at 6 o'clock. Guess what, 6 o'clock, he's not there. I'm like, all right, well maybe work, you know what I'm saying? Maybe traffic, 6:05, he's not there. 6:15, he's not there. 6:20, he's not coming. My dad lied to me, he's not coming. And so I'm walking back to my house and I got tears coming down my eyes and I see my boys walking. They're like, yo, why are you crying, dog? I'm like, nah, dog, I'm not crying, I'm good. I just ate too much cheese, bro, I'm good. Because you gotta lie, right? You gotta pretend. You can't show emotion. As a teenage boy, you can't show emotion. You can't do that. But can I tell you something? That when it's one-on-one, it's just you by yourself in a room, you can't lie to yourself. And so I found myself in my bedroom that day. And I was like, man, why doesn't my dad love me? What's wrong with me? Why doesn't my dad want to be a part of my life? What did I do? What's wrong with me? Because that's the thing, we internalize a lot of things. And so, one of the things that I need to tell you is that at 8 years old, I was in the third grade, I hated school, okay? I didn't like school at the time because they would make fun of me. Because when I started school, I didn't know any English, but I was ready. I remember kindergarten, yes, escuela, I was ready, right? Then I get to the escuela, and they're like, you know your colors? I'm like, yeah. You know your numbers? I'm like, yeah. Blue, red. Yeah, I wouldn't have been a good gangster because I didn't know what blue, red was, but blood, crimp. I wouldn't have known any of that. Like, your numbers, tu sabes tu número? I'm like, no. All I knew was Michael Jackson's Thriller. That's it. But Thriller wasn't going to help me in kindergarten because I didn't even sing it right. I said Thrille, not Thriller. Thrille. Thrille, dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee. Yeah, it wasn't working. So they sent me to my little classroom, and I was in my little classroom for 3 years. But then, in third grade, I was in a regular ed classroom. And so my English, you know, I spoke with an accent. And so kids would make fun of me because of that. I had a weird name. I go by AC because my first name, people can't pronounce my first name. My first name is Abiezer, and when I say that, they're like, what? Ebenezer? Abiezer? No, Abiezer. What? A blazer? Abiezer. We're just gonna call you Abazer. Like, okay, it's better than Abuser, imagine that. Like, hi, my name's Abuser. Oh, that's why the girls are afraid of me. Oh, no, it makes sense. So thank God they gave me Abazer. But I go by AC now. But anyways, I didn't like school. Got made fun of. And so when my father left, became very angry. And so I'm like, you know what? I'm gonna come back to school. And now instead of me being laughed at, I'm gonna laugh at the kids. Instead of me being picked on, I'm gonna pick on the kids. And so I did. Because I thought in fourth grade, like, yo, I'm a little gangster now. Because I started watching all these gang-banging movies, right? I started watching Boys in the Hood, Menace to Society, and I'm Latino, man, so I was watching Blood In, Blood Out, right? Matos Locos Forever, Holmes. But here's the thing. How could I be a gangster when my mom was picking me up? Yo, my mom picking me up, sorry. That's not a gangster, I'm sorry. If your mom picks you up, you are not a gangbanger, I'm sorry. And so even though I pretended to be a gangbanger, with my mom honking, messing up my game, I was not a gangbanger. But I pretended to be. And I started getting in trouble. And I started picking on kids and starting fights and being disrespectful to teachers. See, I was that student. I was a student the teachers didn't like. And so I'll never forget, because life is all about twists and turns. So the end of my fifth grade year, I get to class, and I'm thinking, hey, it's the last week of school, so all we're gonna do is have recess. Yes, right, have recess so I can be outside playing soccer like I'm Lionel Messi and stuff, right? Or Ronaldo, whatever it is that you like. But I had a teacher who was like, no, we're going to review. We're going to review because I want you to get ready for next year. I'm like, miss, I don't want to review. I know everything already. I was that type of kid, too. I know everything. Like, no, we're going to review. I want you guys to go into middle school and be the best writers you can be. So we're going to go over parts of speech, persuasive essays, narrative essays. We're going to do all that. I'm like, miss, I don't want to do that. She's like, go sit down. I'm like, miss, go sit down. I'm like, okay. So I go on and sit down. She's like, all right, so today we're going to start with adjectives. I'm like, miss, I know an adjective. An adjective describes a noun. A noun is a person, place, and thing. Yo, I'm good. I can pass any test. She's like, be quiet. I'm like, okay. So I'm like, man, adjectives. I was upset. I wanted to learn about adjectives. But then it all changed because in walked in this pretty girl. She sat right in front of me. Like, yes, adjectives. And the icing on the cake was, she's sitting right in front of me. So I was like, yes, you're the real MVP, yes. And so the teacher starts, you know, she's going over her adjectives and all that. And so I tap the girl on the shoulder. She turns around, and I'm like, hola. She's like, but I didn't give up. See, I'm resilient. I'm all about perseverance. So I tap her on the shoulder again. What? Like, girl, adjectives. I got this. She's like, leave me alone. But I didn't. So again, I was that annoying kid, right? What? Like, let me break it down for you, baby. Adjectives. A, adorable. B, beautiful. C, cute. D, delicious. She looked delicious, yo. E, elegant. F, fine. G, gorgeous. H, hot. I switched it and turned it in Spanish because, yo, I'm Latino, right? So I did A, adorable. B, bella. C, chula. D, she was like, déjame en paz. She's like, miss. A baser won't stop bothering me. And so Mrs. Craig says, a baser, I need you to leave her alone. Stop bothering her in front of the whole class. And so I stopped bothering her for about 32 seconds. All right, got it. So I tell her, come on, girl. God, practice, right? Let me get your number. Because back then, can I break it down for you and tell you how it was back then? Back then, if you wanted to talk to a girl, you actually had to ask for their telephone number, right? You didn't stalk them on like Instagram and Snapchat, oh, let me have her name. No, you actually had to ask for the telephone number. You had to have the courage to say, can I have your telephone number, please? And risk calling their dad and dad answering the phone. Like, man, that was, yeah, see, you guys have easy. Anyways, so I do that, I tap her, she's like, miss, he won't stop bothering me. And so Mrs. Craig stands up and says, Abazer, I told you to leave her alone. Leave her alone. So what do you think happened then? What did all the students do? They laughed, exactly. Even my best friend was laughing. He's like, I'm like, yo, dog, we're supposed to be boys, what's up? Like, you laughing at me? And so then I stood up because I didn't like kids laughing at me. And I said, Mrs. Craig, I'm not gonna tell you what I told her. Next week's star, you gotta use your inferencing skills, all right? You gotta use your inferencing skills. I'm not gonna tell you what I told her. But I will tell you that after I said, all the kids were like, ooh. Like I passed gas and stuff, right? Like, no, I didn't pass gas. And so the teacher stands up and says, go outside. So I go outside, 5 minutes later, she comes out, hands me an office referral. So I'm going to the office. But I didn't care because me and the principal, we knew each other. It's not like, don't get it twisted. Don't think we were like he was my deal or anything like that. Nah, we knew each other. But again, it's not because he was my family. It was because I had been there in so much, right? I had like my own special chair in his office. Like, y'all, like, yo, that's my chair. Don't sit there, please. I had my own chair in his office. And I was like, okay, so what's it gonna be? What's it gonna be, Mr. Drummond? Is it gonna be this cheek or that cheek? Because back then, they didn't put you in-school suspension. They didn't put you in out-of-school suspension. I mean, you had to do something really bad to be suspended out of school. Back then, is they took a wooden paddle and they paddled you 3 times. So I was like, all right, it doesn't hurt. And I was paddled many times and I would always laugh. And he's like, why are you laughing, son? I was like, because my mom hits harder. Like, you ever met a 5'3" Latina? Like, yo, changla, right? But she took it farther. She took it farther. She got that mata mosca, that fly swatter, right? Yeah. Exactly. And I had like this fascination with Ninja Turtles. So one day she's like, get me Ninja Turtle. I got your Ninja Turtle right here. I got your Leonardo. I got Leonardo, right? So yeah. You know, his paddle, it didn't hurt. So there I was, I'm like, here, I got this, what's it gonna be? He's like, no. He's like, go to the cafeteria, get your lunch, I'll talk to you after lunch. I'm like, perfect. I got 30 minutes to get out of this, right? Because I'm a trickster, I'm gonna get out of this. So 30 minutes passed, I go into his office. He says, why did you say that to Mrs. Craig? So my plan A was deny. You deny. I'm like, sir, I didn't say that. Nah, sir. Like, Miss Craig, she getting old. You know, I think she needs a hearing aid. You ever talk to her and you're like, Miss Craig, and she's like, huh? See, she's getting old. He's like, son, she's not getting old. Why did you say that? Okay, so plan A failed. Plan B was kind of silly. Very silly. But it's true. Plan B, all of a sudden, I forgot how to speak English. I'm like, sir, me English no very good, sir. English no very good. I said forget you, sir, forget you. I know it sounds like I said the other word, but I said forget you. That's what I said, sir. He's like, that's not the F-O-R-U-U, son. I'm like, oh, okay, plan B's not working, right? So plan C, all of a sudden, you got to speak English properly. You're right, sir. You're right. I did it. So what's it going to be? This cheek or that cheek? He's like, no, I'm not doing that this time. I'm like, all right, cool. Yeah, you realize it don't work. Very good. He's like, sit down. I'm like, okay. He's like, I'm going to suspend you. I'm like, sir, it's the last week of school. He's like, no, I'm tired of you. I'm tired of you thinking that you can just get away with everything. Disrespecting teachers. You're not going to do that anymore. I'm like, sir, come on, man. Like, please, the last week of school. He's like, no. He's like, we're calling your mom. I'm like, sir, please don't call my mom. I said, forget you. I promise. I promise don't call my mom. Because back then, you didn't call mom. No, not my mom. At her job, it's not local, it's not, are you crazy? 5'3", full of fire, came in. I'm like, sir, she's going to kill me. No, she's not, she's smiling. I'm, sir, that's an evil smile. You ever heard that an evil smile? And she's like, 3 days, she tried to be all like sweet and stuff to the principal. 3 days suspension, thank you very much. I'm like, thank you very much, what are you talking about? You should be like fighting it. Oh, so she grabs me, 3 days suspension, thank you, Mr. Right? Oh my gosh, and she starts pulling me by my ear. pulling it. I thought I was gonna lose my ear. I thought I was gonna look like a teacup for the rest of my life. Like Starbucks mug for the rest of my life. Seriously. A little tea mug, you know, teacup from Beauty and the Beast, right? Chip. I got a little powder, man, you know what I'm saying? Like, anyways, so we're gonna pause right there. And let me show you this. So that's me. That's me as a little punk kid. Like, yo, what up, right? So we're gonna stop right there, right? My mom's pulling my ear. This is in the sixth grade. I'm still thinking I'm all that. I got my little chain, 24, I got my little basketball jersey, right? Fake basketball jersey. But anyways. And so, before I get back to that part of the story, I want to share three things with you that I really want you to take to heart. Okay, you guys are doing this so far? Enjoying it?
Yeah?
Very good, very good. So number one is this, that the time is now. What do I mean by that? What I mean by time is now, I mean that, you know what, so many times, you know what y'all do? You know what we do as humans, as individuals? We say that, hey, next week I'll do this, or in 3 years I'll do that, or 4 years from now I'll do this, or when I graduate high school, when I graduate from college, or whenever I get married, whatever, you start saying that in a couple of years or in a couple of months, I'll start acting better. But you know what? The reality is that the time is now. The choices you make today affect tomorrow. The choices you make today affect today. And so I'm telling you, don't wait for next year. Don't wait till you're a senior. What you do now is important. And I know sometimes you're like, man, I hate school. I don't want to be in school. But you know, again, what you do now is important, because what can happen is you can get to your senior year, and guess what? 3 years that you wasted clowning around. I'll give you a perfect example. A couple of weeks ago, I was going to get a haircut. And the beautiful thing about the person who cuts my hair, she was actually my student. In the fourth grade, she wrote an essay that said, when I grow up, I'm going to be a hairstylist. I kept that letter. She graduated from high school. I sent that letter to her. I said, Jessica, because in the high school where she graduated from, they had a cosmetology program. So once she graduated, she had a cosmetology license. I sent her that letter. I said, hey, remember what you said? She became that. So anyways, that's the cool thing. I'm going to get my haircut from her because she hooks it up, yo. She hooks it up. She's the manager. And so, like, I don't have to pay, like, full price. Legit. Anyway, as I'm walking there, this kid runs out. He's not even a kid. He's 22 years old. Yo, he's like, Mr. Cristales, remember me? And I remember him. Like, yo, yeah, what's up, Luis? He's like, man, I just wanted to tell you thank you. He's like, you were right. You were right all along. He's like, remember all those guys that I was hanging out with? And he started naming them. He's like, they all locked up, man. He's like, you were right. He's like, I got two kids and I'm trying to get my life in order. I got two little sons and I'm going back to school. I'm going to a community college. He's like, I just want to tell you that you were like my dad. I wish I would have listened to you. This is why I say time is now, because you know what he said? He said, I wish I would have listened to you. And you know that's the thing that's scary? Is that you don't want to live 5-6 years from now and say, man, I wish I would have listened to what my principal, my counselor, my teachers told me. Because sometimes you think they're just nagging on us. But the reality is that they care about you. So, time is now. Number two is the greatest gift. The greatest gift that we as adults have, as we as individuals, as humans, okay? Humans, is the gift to choose. You choose. No one can take that away from you. Do you understand that? That they could take away your boyfriend. You know how this, she took away my boyfriend. They could take away your boyfriend. They could take away your money. They could take away your girl, but they can't take away your power to choose. No one can take that away from you. And in fact, I read that revelation came to me from a book I read about a Holocaust survivor, Dr. Viktor Frankl. Dr. Viktor Frankl lost his mom, his dad, his brother, and his wife in the Holocaust. And yet, after he survived it, he wrote that, you know what, you can strip man away from everything. That means you can take everything away from man but this, and that is a power for man to choose what type of attitude he's going to have. So right here, what you have that you need to realize is that you have the power to choose. Again, maybe you don't like the way your life is going, but you know what, you can change that. Again, maybe you don't like how things have been going in the past, but again, you have the power to change that. You can make those decisions to change that. Number three, you hold the pen. You're writing your story. No one's writing it for you. You're not a puppet. No one's stringing you along like that. You hold the pen. You write your story. You change it. You're the star of this movie. You ever want to be a star? You're the star of your movie. And no one can change that. So, let me go back to this. That right there is Mrs. Purvis. She was my fifth grade homeroom teacher. Not the teacher that I cussed out, not her. She probably left me, right? So this is Mrs. Purvis. So, let's go back to my mom's pulling my ear, right? My mom takes me to my aunt's house because she has to go back to work. And so we're there and she starts screaming at me and crying, and I hated seeing my mom cry. I hated that because I had seen my mom cry too many times. I saw my mom cry when my dad hit her. I saw my mom cry when my dad physically, you know, abused her. And now she was crying because of me and I didn't like that. And so my mom cries, she's crying hysterically, faints. She faints. And I had never seen anybody faint before in my life. So I get down and I'm like, yo, mom, please get up. Like, mom, please, I'm sorry. Like, mom, are you okay, mom? And then you start making all these promises, right? Like, mom, I'll go to church, mom, I promise. Like, mom, I'll do well in school, I'll get straight A's. And so thank God that she was okay. She gets up a couple minutes later. This is how I know she was okay, because the first thing that she did was, right on the head. Okay, you good, mom, you good. Mom, you good. But again, that was that opportunity where I was like, man, I have to make a choice because I don't want to be this type of student. So you know what I did in sixth grade? I started doing better, but still, you know, I had the wrong influences in middle school and seventh grade. And then in eighth grade, I finally started writing. That was my therapy. I started writing. Because my mom didn't have money to send me no counselor. I mean, seriously, this is how I realized we didn't have money. Because one time I hurt my elbow playing football, and my elbow, bam, like huge, right? I'm like, mom, look at my elbow. She's like, you know we ain't got no money. I'm like, mom, come on, look at my elbow. She's like, well, then Vicks. I'm like, mom, what do you mean Vicks? Yo, Vicks ain't gonna do nothing for this, mom. What are you talking about, Vicks? Well, then Vicks. I'm like, come on, mom. So I'm like, okay, you know what? Guess what? Like, I'm not gonna be able to go to counseling and talk about my problems. So I started writing. I was 14 years old when I wrote this. It said 12/22, 1981, mama gave her to another son. But little did I know that growing up in the hood wouldn't be that good, cause well, it was hell where I dwelled. In my home didn't have no pops cause he was gone. And my mama, she was always working. While me and my brother, we were always hurting. And this was at the age of 8, so I'm thinking to myself, could this be my fate? Thinking about my family with hate and crying every night, hoping that someone would come and hold me tight and tell me everything's okay. But it wasn't that way, it was just the opposite. Asking God why it had to be me, and why can't I just have a happy family without hearing my mama cry and my daddy lie? But that's when I made a declaration that I would be someone in this nation. Oh man, I gotta finish up. So I meet with my teacher. She tells me, you know what, I believe in you. Changed my life. There's more to the story, but again, for the sake of time, I can't share that. But I wanna tell you this. I wanna ask you this, actually. What will your legacy be? See, you've laughed today. Hopefully, you know, you've enjoyed the rap. And hopefully you've taken something to heart. So when I say legacy, it's like, how do you wanna be remembered? Because again, your story, when people look at your story, how do you want to be remembered? Do you want to be that person that just gives up on everything? Do you want to be that person who just starts? You know that a lot of people start, they start like, I'm going to do this, I want to do this, but they never finish. See, in here, I want you to be a person that finishes. I want you to be a person that says, hey, you know what? I want to go to college, and I'll do whatever it takes to go to college. I want you to be the person that says, hey, you know what? I'm going to own my own business one day. Regardless of all the struggles and trials and tribulations that come my way, that's what I want to do. So I want you to be the person that finishes. And you know how you're going to do that? It's by knowing your why. It's by knowing why you fight. It's by knowing that you have a reason, that people are looking up to you. By knowing that there's someone that you fight for. You got something, you have a reason. And these are my reasons right here. That's my mom right there. She's smiling, right? She's smiling because she ain't gotta pull my ear anymore, right? And that's my daughter right there. My 7-year-old little girl who looks up to me. That's my 7-year-old little girl who every day I have to tell baby you're beautiful. Every day I need to tell a baby you're smart. Every day I need to tell a baby you're intelligent, because I want her to know those things. Because I don't want her to get to middle school and then her think, am I smart? Am I beautiful? And then have some other guy say, hey. Anybody ever tell you you're beautiful? Like, yeah, she has. Me. Go away from my daughter, man. That's my reason. That's why I don't give up. That's why I don't give up. So let me ask you something. Do you know why you won't give up? Do you have your reasons? I got a lunchroom full of dreamers in here. More than 80% of you raised your hand and said, I have a dream, sir. So I want you to finish it. I want you to put that plan down and say, hey, I'm going to do it, whatever it takes. Why? Because I was able to do it. See, I wasn't supposed to be here. Do you understand that? Do you understand if society would have had its way, I would have never been here? My dad was a drug addict. My dad was in and out of prison. I was raised by a single mom. My first language was not English. I was an English second language learner. Do you understand that all the cards were stacked against me, but yet I'm still here? So if I can do it, then I want to be able to tell you that you can do it too, that there's nothing in this world that can stop you but you. So what will you do? What is it that you're going to do? How will you finish? Because everyone in here has a gift. Everyone in here has a talent. And if you remember anything, remember that. Guys, you've been a great audience. I hope you enjoyed this. Have a great weekend.